Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 3 in private. Are members content? Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session on the disability employment gap. The committee agreed to take some initial work into this area to identify and address the barriers for disabled people getting into employment. And although we are hearing from the Minister today, our call for views does remain open for another week. We do encourage people to contribute to that. So last week we heard from Fraser Valentine Institute along with Enable on structural barriers faced by disabled people in access and employment. And since then we have been to visit Dovetail Enterprises in Dundee with Enable Works. And on Monday we went to visit National Autism Scotland. National Autistic Society Scotland, apologies, to find out about their work in assisting young people into employment. So I now welcome Richard Lockhead, MSP, Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work, who is joined with Sarah Ferguson, Interim Deputy Director for Complex Mental Health Care, and Lewis Hedge, Deputy Director for Fair Work and Labour Market Strategy with the Scottish Government. As always, if members and witnesses could keep their questions and answers short and concise, I'll invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the committee. Thanks also for inviting me along today and for the opportunity to discuss the disability employment gap and the progress that is being made, but also the challenges that still remain, which I'm pleased to see the committee are investigating. The latest statistics show that we are making progress, though, and the disability employment gap has reduced by 6.2 percentage points to 31.2 percentage points compared to 37.4 back in 2016. Now, that reduction has been due to a larger rise in the employment rate of disabled people relative to the increase in the employment rate of non-disabled people. So this means we are currently on track to achieve our ambition to halve the gap by 2038 to 18.7 percentage points. However, I think we're all aware that significant challenges do remain, including creating a culture of change in workplaces where disabled people can be welcomed, hopefully, for the benefits they bring. And as you will also no doubt know, the employment gap between disabled people and their non-disabled peers is not a new thing, and it's certainly something that exists throughout the UK and Europe to a greater or lesser extent. So it's clear that no government's found a very simple answer to this issue, but we do know, however, that taking an approach that meets the needs of each disabled person is key to this. And that's why our devolved employability programmes use a person-centred approach to reduce or attempt to eliminate the barriers for disabled people. But we need to do more to support those with learning disabilities, for example. And similarly, young disabled people need support to raise and meet their own aspirations as well through education and beyond. Information is still emerging on the long-term impacts of the pandemic on the disability employment gap. Where it has added to these structural issues, we are doing our best to try and mitigate that. For example, in relation to mental health, where we have established a platform with information and guidance for employers, which I think was something we discussed last time as before your committee, these kinds of issues. Our commitment to at least half the disability employment gap is an integral element of our Fair Work agenda as well in the Scottish Government. We did publish a refreshed Fair Work Action Plan late last year, setting out how we will continue our progress towards making Scotland a leading Fair Work nation, and as part of that, to halve the disability employment gap. So we will continue to work, particularly with those with their lived experience, to continue to refine and develop these employability programmes. And we'll also work with employers to support them to make that cultural change that we want to see in all of Scotland's workplaces.
Thank you, Minister. As I said, the committee are doing a short piece of work into disability employment gap, but one of the areas that we've identified is around data and information that's available. So as you recognise, there's progress has been made in closing the gap, and the committee very much welcome that. But there is some evidence, particularly work that Fraser Vallander have done, to suggest that it's focused in certain groups and certain types of disability, while other groups are further away from the workplace, and particularly they looked at people with learning disabilities. So what are the government, does the government recognise Do you have an understanding of where the progress has been made and what else, where progress needs to be further made? Is the data needed to inform this being adequately collected?
Well, the answer, I'm afraid, to your question is yes and no. Yes, in that we are aware we are making progress in some areas, but I think as the committee's highlighted and your witnesses have raised before, there are data gaps, and as part of our Fairer Work Action Plan, we're looking at improving that in the coming years. So, you know, the biggest issue I think I've come across discussing this with officials over the past few months is obviously disaggregating some of the statistics we do have. For instance, to look at the breakdown of neurodivergent characteristics within disabilities, and therefore quite often members might raise some of these issues in Parliament about people with autism, for instance, and employment issues around that, and it's quite difficult to disaggregate the statistics we do have. I think part of that, no doubt, will be in relation to how the information is collected by the labour force surveys and the other various surveys. So we're committed to looking at that, though, and improving the data, and it has been identified as an issue.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of the commitment, because it is quite a long-term commitment, I think it's 2038 that you're looking to halve the... Is there interim targets? Is there a kind of pathway that's been set out? Or is that dependent on once you have the data? Because you need to know... You know, there has been successes, but what is... Why are we having successes? And where are the areas that we need to focus policy? So are there interim targets? And is there a clear pathway towards meeting that 2038 target?
That's quite a big question, so I'll try and keep my answer brief. I mean, in terms of interim targets, the overall target of halving the disability employment gap by 2038 was set back in 2016, and we have set interim targets as part of that. So we want to achieve disabled employment to 50% by 2023 and 60% by 2030. So currently, 49.6% of disabled people are employed, looking at the 2021 figures, which suggests we are doing well to get to our interim target of 50% by 2023. So there are some interim targets there. And we estimate that we have to improve disability employment by 1.1 percentage point per year. And at the moment, we're achieving 1.2%. So we are achieving our targets, hopefully, and so we have got those interim targets in place. Your question is a big question about why are we making some progress, and you know what the remaining challenges. That's a huge question. I just would say briefly that clearly we have got measures in place to both work with employers to make sure through the Workplace Equality Fund and other means we support people to adapt to make it easier to employ disabled people. Hopefully that's making a difference. We've got other various partnerships with the government and disabled people's organisations and employers working together to try and break down some of those barriers, and we fund these kind of initiatives as well. And I guess finally, the employability programmes clearly have a big emphasis on helping disabled people back into work, particularly Fair Start Scotland, and I think you said you've visited some organisations as well. So hopefully what we're doing is contributing towards that progress. But to be frank, we don't have all the answers. We don't know exactly why we're making this progress, because we don't know what's working the most and what's not. We know it's all helping, but it's quite difficult to give a precise answer.
Mm. I suppose I'm just going to add to that difficulty, because I'm going to ask him, in the session we had with Enable and Fraser Valander, they did talk about an increase in people with poor mental health, and you mentioned COVID and long COVID being in there as well, and how that was impacting on the figures. Some of those people are already in work and who are then classified as disabled, so that might be contributing towards the improvement we're seeing of people in work with a disability, but also the impact of poor mental health. I don't know if you want to maybe comment on that. Has there been any kind of work being undertaken to assess what the impact of trends in those areas are having on the overall figures? It might be that I think Susan works particularly in that area. I don't know.
Yeah, I'll bring maybe Susan in a second. I mean, I think in terms of the big picture, as I said in my remarks, some of the evidence is still emerging in terms of the impact of COVID on people with disabilities. I think our view at the moment is that there is not any evidence there's been a disproportionate impact of COVID on disabled people, but there has been an impact. But we can't sit here and say there's been a disproportionate impact. And there's various bits of evidence that show there's been impacts, but there's no overall, you know, evidence it's more than any other part of the population or people with long-term sicknesses or, and so on and so forth. And in Scotland's, it's got an older population, and therefore the percentage of disabled people in the working population is slightly higher than the rest of the UK. So these factors all influence, I think, you know, where you're coming from with your question. But I'll bring Susan in to maybe speak about the impact of COVID and mental health issues and so on.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, obviously we would recognise that there has been an impact from COVID in terms of mental health just on the broader population. I don't have the specific statistics you're asking for, but as you'll know, there's a range of work going on around recovery in relation to mental health. So we published a transition and recovery plan for mental health in 2021. We've been doing a range of work around that. We have some actions in there on employability and mentally healthy workplaces for, you know, the whole range of people, including people who are disabled. And so we've been working quite a lot with employability colleagues around their fair work agenda, and also with partners, so employers and trade unions, to take forward work to, I suppose, improve the offer that employers have for people who are mentally unwell, and also, you know, that whole system approach to sort of keep people well, to stop them from getting ill in the first place. So I think...
So I'm just going to ask, so in terms of the data and statistics, has work being done to collect it? Because you've described how challenging it is and some of it's not in place yet. And because the target we're heading towards is a number-based target, so in order for us to see the progress that's been made, we need to kind of know the baselines and the... So is there work being done within the Scottish Government to collect and collate some of this data, to have a better understanding of what makes up the disability employment gap and where we are making progress and where more progress needs to be made?
I think only in terms of what I was saying previously about the disaggregating the headline statistics to understand the impact on people with different disabilities is where a lot of the work's going to be focused going forward. But, you know, if you look at the stats for people with disabilities in employment, there has been a steady increase, and we've increased from 251,000 people in 2014 to 407,000 people in 2021, the end of December 2021. So clearly, once the new stats come out for the subsequent year, we might see there's an impact on the number of disabled people in employment and what the relationship is with COVID. To see if we can identify any trends there, because we've only got figures up until the end of 2021, which begins to take that into account. But clearly, as more data becomes available in the labour market, we can see if there's any trends.
I'll bring Graham Simpson's request in a supplementary. I'll bring him in for a brief supplementary, and then I'll bring in Michelle Thompson.
Yeah, thanks. So just to follow up on that. So, Minister, you say you've got these targets, you say you're making progress, but you also say, if I picked you up right, you don't know why or how you're making progress. Would that be accurate?
Well, what I'm saying is it's difficult to pick one particular factor that's led to the progress we are making, because there's various things happening. It's a complex area. As we've discussed before, we've got many people with different types of disabilities. There's lots of crossover between long-term sickness and disabilities. But we are seeing the statistics going in the right direction, and more people with disabilities getting into work and the gap closing. So we are making progress, but we're doing lots of different things to address that. I'm just saying it's difficult to say which factor is having the biggest impact.
So I mean, that's brilliant. We're making progress, and the government is funding various schemes, but it seems to me that if you are funding these schemes, some will be doing better than others. Would it not be a good idea to drill down into the data around individual schemes and see which ones are more successful than others, and then replicate the ones that are working better?
Well, we do evaluate Fair Start Scotland, where a lot of people with disabilities are helped, and also No One Left Behind, which is delivered at a more local employment partnership level in each local authority. So these are evaluated, these schemes, But this is not just about schemes, it's about culture. It's about the fact, for instance, at the moment we've got labour shortages in Scotland, and I think employers are now being a lot more open-minded to try and adapt, to encourage perhaps people with disabilities to come into the workplaces. So, you know, it's not just about funded schemes. These help, and these help people who we're targeting through the employability schemes. But there's lots of other different factors here that the culture is changing in Scotland. Many more employers are engaging and opening their minds to take on disabled employees. So that's quite difficult to measure.
We have heard, I think other people come to it, we've heard a lot about the need for in-work support. Though once you have someone, you know, it's good that they're in employment, but the importance of providing that future support. But I'll bring Michelle Thompson in to be followed by Colin Smith.
Good morning. I suppose just carrying on the theme that we've already started to discuss in terms of data, I'd just like to understand a bit more about your specific plans, fully accepting the complexity that you're talking about in terms of type of disability, because we have some data, but data is absolutely at the heart of getting an accurate picture. So can you just give me a bit more of a flavour? Obviously, you said you're looking at it, but what exactly and what sort of plan dates do you have to reach a conclusion or recommend new data collectors and so on? Do you have any further information about that?
Yeah, there is work underway, and I probably would take me a while to dig it out of here, but I'm happy to follow that up, the exact timetables. But we are reviewing some of our plans. I think 2024 comes to mind in terms of that being a target date. But we rely on people self-reporting, you know, disabilities.
I was going to go on to that,
So, and Scottish Government doesn't collect all the data. Obviously, a lot of the labour market data is collected at UK level. So we're doing, we've given a commitment to look at what we can do in Scotland to improve the data. I know Lewis will be wanting to say something here because he's much closer to this particular aspect.
So on the specific commitment, so the refreshed Fair Work Action Plan published in December includes a big commitment there, which is around a whole kind of programme of kind of data and evaluation around fair work in the round. Mm-hmm. That's a piece of kind of analytical and evaluation kind of work that we'll be running this year, with a commitment that later this year we'll have that plan in place. I think, as the Minister's pointed out, this will be looking at what else we can do that sort of sits alongside the existing kind of official kind of statistics. So that's sort of the big piece there. And then I guess the other bit is in terms of how we then kind of factor all of this into the design of programmes going forward. So kind of Fair Start Scotland, No One Left Behind, have their own mechanisms for kind of bringing in that level of understanding, kind of the user experience and all of those other kind of aspects around kind of the person-centred approach.
You're simply highlighting what I believe, that it's very complex, and so it would be certainly for me useful to understand a bit more deeper what you're planning, because actually it's very, very complex when we start to think about cross-cutting issues, and we know we've got different data sources. Because leading on from that, it strikes me that obviously there's a number of programmes in place and we want to measure their success by various data collectors, of which we've got some, but also thinking about how then we could, for example, introduce conditionality into various grants and so on. So that would be useful to understand. And also, you mentioned culture, which is a very fair point as well, and linking in with self-ID, where people may, for very good reason, be reluctant. So I suppose, as part of those plans, do you have anything else that looks at how you might support businesses in developing a culture of awareness and a culture of data collectors that you would be able to support, conditional on if they were getting grants potentially? So that's another question about the depth.
Okay, two questions there I'll try and answer. The first question is about the Fair Work agenda, essentially, mm-hmm. and conditionality. So we're constantly evolving the Fair Work agenda in Scotland, and it's crucially important, because the more that employers sign up to the Fair Work Agenda, the more they benefit in terms of being more productive, retaining staff, easier to recruit staff, and more profitable. And of course, then the more people can get into work, and that benefits individuals in terms of their own well-being and self-esteem, getting into work, and that's also very good for the economy. So at the moment, the Fair Work Agenda is, of course, some broad themes, and one of those themes is flexibility. So we look now at, in terms of the criteria for supporting businesses with public grants and contracts, fair work criteria, that includes flexibility. So we are urging employers to be much more flexible. That in turn will help disabled people get into work. So the more flexible an employer is, the more attractive they are, and the more easy it will be for disabled people to work for that organisation. So that's where the Fair Work Agenda plays a role. And in terms of helping to employers to adapt and hopefully change their culture, there are many different initiatives underway. So for instance, I visited the Salveson Mind Room in Edinburgh a few weeks ago, and I'd urge the committee to find out more about that or visit. They're working on neurodivergent issues, and I met various employers, big employers from the Edinburgh area, who effectively have been changing their recruitment policies and taking on board how they can adapt to get people working for them with different neurological conditions. So that was an interface between the organisation and employers, and there's lots of employers in the Edinburgh and Lothian area engaged in that now. It'd be great to see that going national. And then, of course, you've got the Workplace Equality Fund, which funds very different projects across the country, which that's one of the projects that does fund, actually, is the Salveson Mind Room. Part funds it, a lot of it comes from the Salveson family. But that fund alone is about that. It's about working with employers and helping them adapt and learn about how they can be more accessible for disabled employees.
My last kind of question is that, I mean, obviously one would expect the larger employers to have the resources, notwithstanding anything else, to be able to adapt. But, you know, still, what, 99.3% of our businesses are SMEs. So have you given any specific consideration as to how you might be able to support them beyond the broad principles of Fair Work in terms of guidance?
Yes, so it's worth noting that all businesses are subjected to Fair Work criteria. But, of course, our Fair Work First criteria is proportionate. You know, we know it's more challenging for a small business to get through some of the hoops than a much bigger business, so it's proportionate. And the enterprise companies and others who are applying that criteria, you know, take that into account. So I think what we're trying to do just now is raise awareness amongst all employers in Scotland, small, medium, large, and break down some of the cultural barriers. We know, you know, there's, I'm sure the committee's come across this, that many employers just think, oh, this is going to be really costly. You know, maybe a small business might think, I can't afford to adapt my workplace to take on a disabled employee. And there's a lot of awareness raising going on. Some of the projects we fund are just, they're projects about raising awareness and working with all kinds of employers. So I think there's a lot of work to be done there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Colin Smith to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Minister, you talked about how you're close to reaching the 50% target for the employment rate for disabled people, but when you look specifically at the figure for autism, it's a pretty shocking 16% compared to the wider population of 73%. Yet this committee is being told constantly by employers that they've got real labour supply shortages. They're obviously missing out on a really talented workforce. But given that this priority group should be being supported to tackle that low figure, why are organisations that work with, for example, young people with autism being plagued by really considerable delays when it comes to funding? A lot of these organisations were told they would have decisions made on government funding by the end of December. They're now being told that's been delayed well into the next financial year. And that obviously makes it impossible for these organisations to plan, and in some cases actually is leading to them being under threat because they're having to hand out redundancy notices to staff because it's beyond the financial year that they're being notified of funding. So what's caused these delays, and can you explain to us what the extent of these delays are?
Well, thanks for raising the issue with me, and I'll certainly investigate that, because I can't pretend I've had that feedback. So maybe other ministers have had feedback in their own portfolios dealing with some of these organisations. However, I'm sure the members are aware, as are others, of the very volatile economic environment just now that the government's been experiencing over the last few months, and the pressure on public finances. So the draft budget's before Parliament just now, and it's not been as easy as we'd like to give many organisations across Scotland and all many different sectors the assurances they've wanted because of the financial situation facing the Scottish Government and the budgets. And we all know the reasons behind that. So we will do our best to give people as much notice as we can. And I'm happy to investigate the organisations.
I can give you an example of it. I appreciate another portfolio, but here's one letter to a third sector organisation. Thank you for your application to the Scottish Government's Children, Young People, Families and Adult Learning Third Sector Fund. Well, we had planned to inform applicants of funding decisions by the end of 2022. Unfortunately, this will not happen. As a result, the funding decisions will be shared in early 2023 with the intention of commencing in July 2023. Now, that means that anybody who employs staff is having to hand out notices because, you know, they've got that nine-month figure of having to have funding to pay salaries. So you have that real uncertainty. So I mean, I hope you do investigate that, because I think this committee has had real difficulty being able to get to the bottom of the extent of this. We're being told there's different delays right across the board, but nobody's telling us in detail from government why the delays are taking place and how much funding in the budget has been delayed and what the impact is. One of the issues that has been raised by organisations is why are we not moving to a position of multi-year funding? Now, I know the challenges around that. We have this debate every year. We should be having it every 3 years, but we have it every year. But there must be a way in which priority projects dealing with this are not at least given a minimum commitment of funding over more than 1 year in order to avoid issues such as this. You know, we know that budgets vary, but the whole government budget doesn't vary. So when it comes to priority projects, you don't tell local government we're going to completely stop all your education funding, maybe not a good example to choose, but all your education funding. They know there's a minimum level in the baseline that's going to be carried over each year. So why, for priority projects, don't we have a minimum level over more than one financial year, knowing that it may change the overall figure?
Yeah. Well, I know it's been an ongoing debate for many years, and I've got many organisations in my own constituency that make the same points to me on a regular basis. And, you know, I can only point to the enormous pressures on the Scottish budget. Our Scottish budget, unfortunately, doesn't vary as much as we'd like it to vary. So, but the demands do. The demands in the budget vary all the time, and we can see the huge demands in the Scottish budget just now. And there's only so much you can cut the same cake over and over without growing the cake. And the demands are, you know, they're in the news every day of the week for anyone to see on the Scottish budget just now. So we'd like to be in a position to give much more long-term certainty to these organisations. But until the Scottish budgets get the same long-term certainty, you know, we're unable to do that in the current time. But we take on board the point, and we know it is not an ideal situation, but it's just a symptom of where we are with the pressure on public finances at the moment.
These particular cases of delaying it into the financial year, of course, are not a long-term thing. They are a very short-term challenge at the moment. And, you know, it would be good for the committee to hear back what the full extent of this problem is for disabled people across portfolios, because I appreciate it does cut across portfolios, and what action the government are taking to try to tackle that, because it is causing a lot of uncertainty.
Give a further update to the committee, and I'll speak to finance.
And I did obviously raise a particular case in the chamber with yourself a few weeks ago, I'm sure.
Yeah, of course. I was just making the point that I'm sure that the projects you mentioned are extremely important, but every project and every organisation that comes to us sees itself as a priority and very important. It's a very difficult balance to strike.
Thank you. Graham Simpson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks again, Convener. We've heard some evidence that really the journey for people into employment starts when they're at school, and it can start very early. So if you don't catch kids when they're at even primary school, identify youngsters who have learning difficulties and start to help them at that point, then their life chances later are diminished. So, I mean, first of all, do you accept that point? And if you do accept it, are you working with your colleagues in education to, you know, improve the situation? I mean, there was a figure that we've had that if you, you know, once you get to the end of your school life and possibly think about moving either into employment or further education, then we can see the figures are quite stark. For instance, higher education school leavers with learning difficulties, there's only 10.4% of them go into higher education, which compares to 48.7% of pupils without a learning difficulty. So you can see the issues. If people are leaving without decent qualifications, then their chances of getting a job are diminished. So we need to start early.
Yes, and firstly, I think it's fair to say we do agree with the sentiments of what you're saying there, and it's becoming an issue that's getting a lot more recognition in government and general debate around particularly issues relating to young people and disabilities. As you may know, we've now committed to the first national transitions to adulthood strategy. So the government is now committed to that, which will address this very issue. My colleagues across government are working together on it, because obviously, as Graeme Simpson says, this is about education and, you know, young people coming through school and into the workplace. Ms Hawkey and Ms McKelvey, two of the ministers involved in this, are going to be giving evidence to the Education Committee later this month on this. So you may wish to, as a committee, liaise with them, because they'll be giving evidence on the Members' Bill, which is also before Parliament just now, which you'll be aware of, which is about disabled children and young people and transitions to adulthood. So this is on the government's agenda. We are happy to work with committees and members who are bringing forward members' bills, but we are committed to that first strategy.
Okay, that's interesting. I didn't know about that strategy, so I think it's possibly something that the committee should look at.
Yeah, I'm happy to, if I'm writing following up the committee appearance, I'll incorporate that.
Right. So at the moment, it's been worked on. It's not, it's not been written yet. It's just been worked on.
We've given a commitment to introduce it in this parliamentary term.
Okay.
But I think work on it's imminent. And as I said before, my ministerial colleagues are going to give evidence to your colleagues in the Education Committee about progress and responding to the Members' Bill.
Okay. So that's very useful. I'll just ask you one more question then. It goes back to data. Yeah, do you have any idea how many disabled people are employed in your own department?
I've got Scottish Government figures at Dover Breakdown, and I was actually, the latest figures I have in the Scottish Government, I'm impressed by. So I've got them, I think I'm right in saying that through the Scottish Government Recruitment and Retention Action Plan for Disabled People, which the Scottish Government brought forward a few years ago, in the 8 years I think that's been in place, we've increased the number of disabled employees in Scottish Government from 6.4% in 2013 to 13.3% in 2021. So it's more than doubled in 8 years, and within the Scottish Government there are various teams set up to help adapt different workplaces to help disabled people be recruited and be accessible. So there's a lot of good work taking place in the Scottish Government. So I hope that gives you some assurance that we are trying to set an example.
Okay, thank you.
We did yesterday, on Monday, for those of us that went to the National Autism Society Scotland, hear positive reports about the work being undertaken by the Scottish Government in terms of employing people on the autistic spectrum. They were very favourable about the work that's been done. There was some comment that could learn and be taken from that? Could that example be used to encourage other employers, which points towards a need for more joined up policy and more connected policy, where the earlier points of where something is working well, that needs to be recognised and then spread throughout the country and used as good examples, and maybe that's just not happening enough. So there's pockets of progress and there's pockets where things aren't, and we don't know where's what's happening where. That goes back to the data question. But in terms of schools, there were also, when we went to visit National Autism Society of Scotland, a strong point made about the need for specialist support for young people in schools. So while we might be looking at it from an education perspective, making the case there needs to be specialists, often that is in the third sector, involvement in education, and that needs to be funded in terms of that support. So I understand it's not your portfolio, but it feeds over to, if you're looking at bringing these young people into employment and making them productive members of society, they need a specialist support. It's maybe just not always available in schools, and there needs to be more focus on that.
Yes.
That might be something you could feed back to.
Yeah, I'll certainly
do that. We will speak to the Education Committee about the work they're doing.
And it is worth mentioning, perhaps I should mention this response to Graeme Simpson's point, is there are some trials underway in Scotland. There's one called, we're working with an organisation or initiative called Association for Real Change, and that's working with 10 local authorities at the moment. So some of the issues I was speaking about with Graeme Simpson are kind of being trialled at the moment. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we're committed to a national strategy, as I said, in this parliamentary term. So that trial is designing and testing changes that improve planning and delivery of support for young people who need that additional support as they make the transition into young adult life. So I'm happy to follow up again with some more information about that to the committee. But I think that gives us a reassurance that these mm-hmm. issues are on the agenda, and they are now, for the first time, being implemented and trialled. And I'm happy to come back to you and what my education colleagues are doing.
Thank you. Colin Beattie to be followed by Jamie Halko-Johnson.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, witnesses have raised the issue about support services being inconsistent across the country, and specifically that it's a bit of a lottery as to the quality of these support services and the range of them. And this is particularly true in remote areas, in rural areas, where there seems to be a limited number of service providers, poor transport, poor digital connectivity in some places. Now, the Scottish Government has a model, No One Left Behind, and I'm just wondering how the Scottish Government can ensure that minimum service levels are offered while retaining some flexibility there.
We carried out a review into supported employment, which reported last year, and we're working our way through the recommendations of that. So I'd want to double check the recommendations that may link to your own question, because they identified a lot of issues along those lines, which we've given a commitment to take forward. In terms of No One Left Behind, I take on your point about a single standard across the country and the postcode lottery issue. Now, I think obviously if the committee in your inquiry has more to say in that, I'll certainly want to hear that. But No One Left Behind is about person-centred support. So on a local basis, people who are getting help, kind of bespoke help for their own needs, the caseworker helping them will deal with transportation issues and other issues. So we're trying to have that approach where it's person-centred. So if a person has challenges with transportation in a rural area or elsewhere, they will get some advice and help with that as part of their support package. So that's the kind of the way we're trying to address it just now, is that person-centred approach, helping people. It could be with childcare issues, it could be with transport issues. So that's something that's been developed over the last couple of years and we're hoping to build on.
Do you have any comparative data as to which would support where the provision of services in the more rural and remote areas are in comparison with the urban areas? Do we have anything on that?
Well, I expect the Scottish Government does, so I would happily come back to the committee if you want to. I'll find out if we have that information. I'm sure that must exist at national level.
It would be interesting, because obviously we'd be very anxious that people are not left behind in the rural areas and so on in Scotland. It seems to be a problem not just in this area, but across a lot of the services that are provided. the inconsistency and the difficulties in just logistical difficulties in providing that support that's needed.
Yes, so these issues, you're absolutely right, do affect our rural communities. We have a forum in Scotland. I'm trying to remember the name of it, but there's a forum in Scotland for disabled people and people with mobility issues that advises transport policy and works with transport colleagues. And there's an access to work theme around that as well. So I probably don't have the name in front of me, but that does exist, just to give you assurance. So I'll happily send details of that initiative to you or the forum, and I'm sure they've got their own work streams and issues they're looking at.
Now, although I've taken an obvious comparison between rural areas and, say, urban areas, there is reportedly an inconsistency in support across the country, and that includes urban areas. And I wonder if you've any data on that to compare, support in places like Edinburgh or Glasgow or whatever, where obviously there's a greater concentration of people who would want to use these services.
Not directly. I mean, as I said before, we've moved towards no one left behind over the last 2 or 3 years, which is decentralised, local level, allowing the local employment partnerships to come up with bespoke solutions for their areas. And many of the projects funded locally are for disabled people, as well as other people who are maybe far from the labour market. So it's very much localised. There is, of course, a platform that brings all the No One Left Behind partnerships together and discuss common issues. So hopefully if there's any discrepancies or postcode lotteries that are identified, at the sort of national level. But I don't have any direct data I can give you about comparing different areas.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Jamie Harper-Johnson to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much. Just before I start, I mean, I don't kind of mean to sound unfair on this, but you've come to a committee kind of session on disability gap in Scotland. You can't tell us the figures for your own department that's responsible for, for the number of disabled people working in your own department. You think there's data on rural areas and wider afield, but you don't have that information to hand. I mean, I would have thought this information would be fairly standard to be able to provide if you want to. And if we want to understand the picture across Scotland. So I certainly think it would be helpful to get that information, what information you do have. And I wonder whether it really does, as others have kind of raised the data issue, shows that we're not getting a full idea of the data. And how can we look at where the problems are if we don't have that information to go forward with? Can I just ask, on the following on the kind of postcode lottery side, obviously, you represent a seat in the Highlands and Islands, and I represent the region. It is harder to deliver in rural areas. It is harder to access services in rural areas, and it's a whole wider issue than just the services themselves. It's transport, it's connectivity, it's IT, as others have said. So how do you liaise with other departments on making sure that the work that you have responsible for is deliverable through the work that others areas responsibly, such as the Transport Minister or those responsible for digital? How do you do that liaison with other departments?
So the plans and policies we have in the government are signed up to by all the relevant areas of policy. And the transport question is a wider transport question which affects disabled people but other parts of the population as well. Mm-hmm. And as I said before, there are specific forums that looks at people who have mobility issues, and that's fed into transport policy. So, it's collective government, and all policies are reflected through all areas of government. I did give you the Scottish Government statistics. I don't have a breakdown of that. If it exists, I'll send it to the committee in terms of number of disabled people working for various government departments. but I thought the question was about the Scottish Government's track records, and therefore I gave an answer, which I thought was a good answer, and you know, a credible answer about the Scottish Government's track records. So I do think you're being slightly unfair saying too much that I brought a breakdown for every single policy section across Scottish Government. But if that exists, I will...
Well, I think, and I might be wrong, but I think Mr Simpson's question was actually about your department or the department you're in, but I can check back. But it would certainly be helpful to get that breakdown.
Yeah, I think it exists.
If it doesn't exist, do you think it should exist, that you should know how the number of disabled people in your department, given it's your responsibility?
Yes, but the Scottish Government Civil Service has its plan, which I referred to before, and I gave you the Scottish Government statistics. So, you know, I'm not the Permanent Secretary, I'm not the Civil Service, but I'm delighted with the progress that the Permanent Secretary has made.
You are the Minister, so I would have thought. But okay, I'll move on. We know from the budget that there was a £53 million cut to the employability funding. A number of issues have been raised about the timescales, you know, the short timescales to access funding. What analysis or what impact do you think that will have on the sector and some of the schemes that obviously have been delivered, but also just on the kind of wider issue of the employability gap with that funding being removed?
Yeah. So there's currently just under £70 million for employability support in the draft budget that's before Parliament just now. And the £53.06 million, which was initially budgeted for and then removed, was not cutting existing services. It was to fund additional work we wanted to undertake, but clearly will not happen now because of the money being removed, because of the budget pressures facing the government and the cost of living crisis. So obviously we'll see the budget going through Parliament. So the funding will be there for the employability schemes. There were additional work around tackling child poverty and other issues which we were going to play a role in through employability schemes, but clearly that's not going to happen to the same degree because of the budget being removed.
So it was a simple question of budget rather than a lack of uptake of potential funding?
No, that was solely a budget decision.
Okay.
And as I said before, it was additional money that was going to be coming into the portfolio, which is not now coming, as opposed to cutting the existing budgets.
And just going on the point that Colin Smith was talking about before, you suggested, and it may well have been about the individual cases, that you would look into them and that you were, you weren't aware of them. But I mean, surely you're aware that there's been issues from the sector about the kind of the length of funding parcels, you know, a year when they're looking perhaps longer term. So, what kind of ongoing discussions are you having with the sector on that?
Well, clearly I have discussions through the employability field, but in terms of Colin Smith's examples, I am not aware of being directly contacted by any of those organisations. But of course, it's all part of the general concern expressed by many organisations in the third sector in particular, which I referred to before. And so, we're aware of that. Mm. But these are financial decisions and budget decisions. Yeah. And, you know, I am unable to fix that. Yeah. That's above my pay grade in the government.
No, that's right. But I mean, have been representations that you're aware of from the sector that there is a need or that there is a request for longer funding. So give them.
Yes, and it's a regular point made. I mean, I'm not denying it's a regular point that's made. I think ever since I've been an MSP, you know, going back to 1999, it's been a regular point made by the third sector and other organisations, is they'd much prefer long-term certainty, three-year budgets or whatever. But the way in which the financial settlement set up for the Scottish Parliament, it's not easy to deliver that.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Convener. A couple of quick questions, because a lot of the area I was going to ask about has been covered, but there's 125,000 people of working age who are disabled who have a qualification at degree level, yet disabled people with a degree are less likely to be employed than non-disabled people. And Cerebral Palsy Scotland has suggested there is a need for an online hub so that people can find out information and support on employing a disabled person. Is that something that already exists, or is it something that the government would consider?
I'm not aware of that existing at the moment, but I think Lewis might want to say something.
Yes, on a slightly more general answer to that. So not personally aware of that particular data point, but one of the things, again, in the Fair Work Action Plan, and it goes to the convener's point earlier about kind of promulgating good practice. So you'll see one of the actions in there is how we kind of gather together the good practice that already happens with employers, learning from the Scottish Government as an employer, the outputs from the things that we fund, Workplace Equality Fund, the Public Sector Partnership and so on, and bring all of that together in one place as kind of a package of kind of information support for employers as well. So that's something kind of very active at the moment, how we bring all of that together. And there's a lot of good work already out there. The CAPD already have their own resources, and there are others. So there's a bit about what's the gap we're trying to fill, but there is something about kind of bringing all that together.
Okay. And the other point I was wanting to ask about was, you mentioned about the Scottish Government has doubled its number of disabled people that it employs over the last 8 years. However, when Enable Scotland was giving evidence to the committee 2 weeks ago, they said that at times they find it most challenging to work with public sector. So I was wondering what your perception was. Obviously, we've got public sector, private sector and third sector. Do we have any data that highlights the proportion of disabled people that are employed in each of those sections?
I would revert to the Public Social Partnership, which is the initiative we fund, and that brings together the private sector, the public sector, government and disabled people's organisations. And so I'd certainly revert to them to see if there's a breakdown of their work in terms of the statistics you're looking for there. I would hope the public sector would be an exemplar, and I'd be disappointed if there was any public sector in Scotland that was not being accessible for disabled employees. So clearly you've taken evidence, and I'll wait your report, and if that's identified as an issue, certainly we'd take that very seriously. And your wider point you made earlier about disabled people who are qualified, we're always open to new ideas about how to address that. That's, of course, just symptomatic of the wider disability employment gap and how we need to change the culture in Scotland and our workplaces.
Mm. Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you. Just before I bring Maggie in, so the evidence we took when we went to see Enable about private and public sector, what they described with the private sector, it was easier to, there was more flexibility. It was easier for them to make connections with the private sector. They run things like academies where they would take in maybe 10 of their clients who would spend a week at that workplace. They'd then go through the formal application process. They were finding the public sector didn't have that same degree of flexibility and responsiveness they could get in the private sector. So it wasn't that the public sector was reluctant to employ people, it was just the lead-in time and the relationship building they found easier with the private sector. Just to kind of set a bit more background to that, but that was the evidence that we received around that. Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Claire. And good morning. Thank you for being here this morning and for what you've already told us. I want to focus on two areas, just to drill down around the progress that we've seen around participation rates in the labour market, and then on the action plan and the targets. So on participation rates, we've heard already this morning that we know there is progress. We're not really sure. We can't necessarily pinpoint what is being successful or why it's been successful in certain places. And I just want to pick up on a couple of these things. I suppose, firstly, the question is, what is it that you need to know in order to identify what is and what isn't working? And are you confident that we have a plan to get that information? And it's the raw numbers, but I think there's also something Michelle talked about, culture. There's something else other than just the numbers. But I suppose there are a couple of other questions, and this maybe speaks to Colin and Jamie's points about postcode lottery issues. If the numbers, because that figure, that the participation figure is a nationwide figure, and I suppose, are we sure that it's not masking further inequality in some areas, either geographic areas or sectoral areas, because in the call for views, we've already had a response from the NHS Tayside Disability Employment Network, and they say that it actually seems to them that the gap is widening after initial progress. And I think being able to understand, being able to drill down into that a little bit more and understand the sectoral, the geographic variations, as well as even potentially some intersectional issues, you know, are older disabled people more disadvantaged than younger disabled people, for instance. Can you say a little bit more about how we're actually going to answer these questions?
I think your questions sum up the complexity of the issue we're discussing today, because, you know, there's no easy answers to some of those questions. But I'll try and address your first one first and then come to the second one. So the first one is, where are the best interventions and what would make the biggest difference? And my point earlier on about not being able to identify, you know, the specific reasons why we're making progress is because it is a combination of practical support and supporting people, but it's also a question of changing culture, particularly in workplaces. And that latter is quite difficult to measure. We want to see it happen. It is beginning to happen. So to what extent it's practical support, or to what extent it's culture changing, is quite difficult to measure, and that's the point I'm just trying to make. But I think the biggest obstacle would be cultural change in workplaces. So, you know, since you've asked the question, if we can open the minds of all employers in Scotland that there are steps they can take to tap into the massive talent pool we have in this country, which is the disabled population who are not in work, then clearly that would help address these inequalities. And so I think that's where we have to do what we can to focus on cultural change. And I think there's some positive signs, particularly, as we said before, with some of the big employers. And I think the convener just said that some of the feedback you'd had as a committee was that the private sector is now doing a lot more to be adaptable and flexible. So I think that's the biggest area. In terms of how we identify disparity across the country, I think that's really, you know, from our interventions, you know, the No One Left Behind, you know, each partnership at local level should be looking at its local labour market and coming up with projects, initiatives and funding various work streams to address that. So we have to make sure we're on top of that. Okay. No One Left Behind is relatively new, so we have to understand if some areas are performing better than others and try and identify where there might be gaps in any part of the country.
Okay, and I suppose that links to the point around progress on the action plan and the targets. And you've said you've identified very clearly that we are on course at the moment. I suppose, do you expect, or is it your sense that actually we'll continue with that kind of linear progress, or will there be... Is there the possibility of either speeding that up or actually hitting a plateau? And what's the assessment around the rate of progress, I suppose, over the next 15 years?
So our Fair Work Action Plan has an aspiration that Scotland becomes a leading fair work nation by 2025. Yep. And the action plan's got a lot of measures in there to try and push this forward. And as I said before, you know, we have a situation just now, we've got labour shortages in Scotland. Yeah. So we've got talent pools where people could be working, but we've got labour shortages. So now is the time for both employers to be more open-minded and adaptable and flexible, as well as for government to play its role as much as possible as well. So I think it's really important we speed this up.
Okay. My final point then is just around the... You've talked about the importance of culture change, and I think there's a balance between support at different stages in people's lives across, in terms of supporting the individual, there's support and encouragement and culture change of employers. But I'm wondering as well if you see a challenge between that person-centred support that the policies and plans are based on and sort of broader structural and systemic things, and this maybe speaks to some of the joined upness that we need in the data, but I think we also need in how we think about this, that enhance inclusion for everyone, and where you see the balance between that sort of the focusing on support for the individual versus actually making the sort of structural changes, whether that's making sure there is inclusive transport in rural areas or, you know, whatever it is, how do we get that balance right, and how do we get the joined upness across government? Because it's not only your responsibility, all of this, it connects into so many different other areas.
Yes. Well, as I said in a previous answer, it's the responsibility of all of government to support the Fair Work agenda. Mm-hmm. And therefore, you know, whether it's transport or childcare or education, you know, it's the job of all these areas to support the Fair Work agenda. And but your question is a good question, but you know, the whole point of person-centred approaches is to identify some of those barriers in a local context and then work with local partners to knock down those barriers. So, you know, all of us represent areas of Scotland, and your local employment partnership should be delivering person-centred approaches, as does Fair Start Scotland, the national initiative, and identifying those barriers and working with local partners to knock them down. So that's the benefit of a person-centred approach, mm-hmm. is looking at that particular individual's barriers and then working with local partners to knock them down.
Okay. Thank you. Just before I bring in Fiona Hislop, if it's okay, you referred to the Fair Work Action Plan. There's only two references to people with learning disabilities in that plan, and you know, Maggie Chapman's described it as we're at risk of reaching a plateau in terms of the progress that's been made. And the Fraser-Valander report that I referred to earlier does indicate that people with learning disabilities remain furthest away from the workforce. There's not enough progress in that area. And unless we start to make progress in that area, we're at risk of not meeting the target. Is that an analysis that the Scottish Government agrees with? And you know, is there a clear focus that this is a group of people that we need to concentrate on if we're going to meet the target?
Yes, absolutely. And there are some projects, I think I mentioned the Salvis and Mindroom and others, that are looking at some of these issues and they're relatively new projects. And of course, the Fair Work Action Plan, I know you mentioned it's only mentioned twice, but the Fair Work Action Plan is about, you know, the employment gap facing racialised minorities, the disability employment gap, the gender employment gap, the gender pay gap, etc. So it's a Fair Work Action Plan, and there's the disability employment gap's a big part of that, but it's much wider than just disabilities. The Scottish Government adopted in 2021 the Learning and Intellectual Disabilities and Autism Towards a Transformation Plan, and there's various recommendations coming out of that have been taken forward as well. So I think all of these things are trying to be joined up here, mm-hmm. And there's specific actions within there in the employment sphere. So just to give you an assurance that these things are being addressed, and I'm happy again to include that in my response to the committee.
Okay, thank you. Fiona Hislop.
Good morning, Minister. You talk about an all-government approach, and you'll be aware that the government is planning to introduce a Learning, Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill. That also includes a proposal for a National Commissioner, which the National Autism Society Scotland are very keen on. What engagement have you had with the Minister in the development of that bill, and do you see it as an opportunity and vehicle to improve legislation on employability of people with disabilities?
Yeah. Well, thanks. And yes, it's so that you've highlighted the forthcoming bill, and my officials will be engaging in the employment sphere on that. So whilst that's a bill not just about employment, we will certainly be engaging with that. That's engagement's begun already, but I think things are quite at an early stage. And I don't know if Susan, are you wanting to come in here, I think, to elaborate on your involvement?
Absolutely. Yeah, so just we've been working very closely at official level around the bill, and we'll continue to do so. So I think between May and July 2022, we undertook scoping work. So that was with a range of different people and organisations, including those with lived experience. So I think it was 30 events and 18 different organisations. So we're going to consult on the bill in the second half of 2023, and we're setting up various mechanisms with which to engage with, you know, policy colleagues across the Scottish Government who deal with different issues, also people with lived experience, practitioners and stakeholders. So we're putting all of that in place to inform the development of the consultation, which will take place later this year.
Can you share any early employability themes that you've identified to date from following the work from last year?
Not at this point. I could certainly go away and see if anything specific has been identified around that and respond to you separately.
I think we'd be very interested in that. And similarly, there's a transition bill from Pam Duncan Glancy that's making its way through Parliament. What engagement have you personally had on that, Minister, or your officials in trying to influence that? And again, what themes on employability are you trying to support within that piece of legislation?
So at the moment that's been led by the Education Ministers and Qualities Ministers. So we are keeping a watch and briefing that and feeding in. I've not had any direct involvement with that as Minister. But again, that's at quite an early stage and we're waiting to get the feedback from the other Ministers. But these issues will indirectly, obviously, impact on employability issues. So we will look at that closely.
And can I then move on to, again, cross-cutting work? Because you said it's an all-government approach and your role in making sure that all ministers are actively involved in looking at the employability aspects is really important. The developing the young workforce is very effective in bringing together and being led by the private sector, but bringing different groups together. What progress is being made to ensure that employability for young people with disabilities is embedded in the developing young workforce activity? And is there any good examples you can give us or feedback you can give us on how that's improving?
So the Skills Minister, Jamie Hepburn, answered some questions on this in Parliament just the last few weeks. So if I refer the committee to those answers, because he laid out how that's all being addressed and he's leading on that aspect. So there's a lot in his answers to Parliament about the interaction between supporting young people with disabilities and developing the young workforce and the skills agenda.
So we'll certainly look at that. And I suppose then, just finally, and it's picking up on the points that Graeme Simpson was raising, we were very struck by the evidence that the expectations of young people can be set really, really early for all young people, but particularly with those young people with disabilities. And how those that are working in early years education in primary, their parents or anybody that comes in connection with them, that culture, and you've referred to culture, is really important. So what interventions do you think can be take place to ensure that everyone knows that there's capabilities for young people for the future, and they just have to be given that support? And again, I think it is that culture of expectation. You can do things, and you know the world is there for you, and you will be able to take part in employment. Are you convinced we're doing enough in that area, Minister?
Well, the answer is probably no, because there's a lot of new work underway, which we referred to in earlier questions, about supporting this agenda within schools, in particular transition between school and young people into young adulthood. So I think it's now recognised we have to do a lot more. So it's quite exciting now that all these new policies and plans are going to be developed in the coming months and years to address some of these issues. So there's no doubt a lot more we could do in schools to promote these equalities and to support disabled people in our schools and to be prepared for employment.
And finally, if we have time, I too, as a Premier, was quite struck by the comments that perhaps the public sector is falling behind the private sector in how prepared they are to support people into employment. Actually, I think your default assumption might be think it would be the other way around, but I mean we're getting some kind of steer on that. So you've referred to the Permanent Secretary already, but clearly as the leader within the civil service, they're in a strong position to ensure this is addressed. Is that something that you can take up with him, and is that a discussion you have with him in terms of not just his leadership of the government civil service, but across all public sector, that there's a leadership role for the Permanent Secretary in this regard?
Absolutely. And, you know, I too was struck by your comments as a committee that this has been identified as an issue. So what's the benefit of having a committee inquiry is to take evidence and flag up some of these issues to to Parliament and ministers. So yeah, I'll definitely take that message away from today, and I'll certainly investigate that and obviously await your recommendations.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Just a couple of final questions. In the written responses we received from Enable and also Social Enterprise Scotland, they have pointed to the focus has been on providing support to get disabled people into work, but maybe doesn't recognise the importance of in-work support and making sure that is sufficiently funded to enable people to retain employment. And when we visited Enable, they had, you know, pretty good figures on retention, but it was achieved through a very kind of one-to-one support, workers who weren't overloaded with a caseload that could provide the level of support that people need. Is that recognised as being an important part of the strategy here on how to increase the employability, how to decrease the gap? That it's not just about getting people into jobs, that will have an impact on the gap, it's about retention and keeping them in employment. And also, we've heard yesterday about progression, about career progression for people. It's not just once they're in employment, it's about the ambition and aspirations that can be achieved through that. Is that recognised as an important part of what we need to do here?
So, in answering that, I have to obviously just refer to the fact that a lot of these issues are reserved to the UK government. So the Access to Work scheme, which I think is probably the most obvious source of funding for employers, and I think it's quite substantial funding. I'd have to check the figure, but I think it's over £60,000 that can be made available to help adapt workplaces to allow access to work for disabled people. So clearly that's a UK responsibility, not the mm-hmm. Scottish Government. And that obviously got a very important role to play. And I understand one of the issues around that is just awareness. Is mm-hmm. just raising awareness with employers that that support is available from the UK government. Maybe there's more of a role we could play as a Scottish government to raise awareness of that as well. Obviously, it's not a responsibility, and we can't, you know, take responsibility for that per se. But I think your point, a valid point, is that, you know, we want employers to know that assistance is there, mm-hmm. and it's quite substantial. So that really is the answer to your question: is there is support there? It's a UK government scheme. We have funded projects that look at the, you know, the specific projects about working with employers, but actual financial support for individual cases would be through Access to Work. And in terms of the culture within workplaces, yes, it's an important issue you raise about career progression. Again, it's a cultural issue for employers that could take you into areas, again, which are reserved, which are ongoing debates over mandatory reporting of disabled employees and the figures around that. I don't know whether that debate would include also managerial positions, etc., etc. But there's debates around mandatory reporting for employers, which is a reserved issue. And UK ministers are looking at a number of issues just now. I know the House of Commons Committee did a similar inquiry last year, or 2021. Last year, this is now 2023, so it's 2021. The House of Commons Committee did an inquiry into disabled disability employment gap, and they looked at some of these issues. You might want to look at there. I don't know if you've seen it, but no.
We did hear about the Access to Work programme, which, as you recognise, is, you know, is quite well funded. We did hear difficulties with delays and the application process, and we will follow that up. However, it wasn't just about that type of support. It was also, the question was about the support that we give in Scotland to the third sector and other organisations, that they talked about the importance of continuation of services. So the same organisation that has helped you gain the confidence to apply for jobs and got you through that service is often the organisation that is best placed to provide the in-work support. And sometimes funds will be drawn down from Access to Work, but other times that is funded by Scottish Government or by local authorities. And we did hear positive feedback about Dundee and Edinburgh, the way in which they decided to give some security of funding to those organisations to continue that work. That goes back to the postcode lottery question. That's not happening everywhere. But does the government recognise, putting aside the Access to Work programme, which is important, and, you know, people should access that, and we should have more information on that, and it should be higher profile, there is also a job for the Scottish Government to do about supporting people once they're in employment and securing their employment and making sure organisations are funded to provide that. Do you see that as part of the strategy?
Yeah, I'm happy to take that point away as well, and if that's what the organisations have been raising with you, that's something certainly we'd take on board. I don't, you know, you know, I'd be happily discuss that with these organisations. Uh-huh. I meet these organisations quite regularly, and I fulfil visits around the country. So I know some really good stuff happening, but clearly, if there's issues, I'm happy to find out more about that.
Yeah. And the final question that
I
was.
I think Lewis wants to come in at one point.
So if I may, just on the devolved element, so one of the things that Fair Start Scotland does, obviously, as well as the 12 to 18 months support for the individual kind of get progressing towards work, there's also up to 12 months of in-work support for the individual and the employer. I'm happy to kind of provide more information on what that is and how that looks, but we do provide that kind of for that first year after.
Mm-hmm. That's helpful, thank you.
And I expect, like yourselves, you know, when I visited Fair Start Scotland projects or offices around the country, I was at the opening of their new office in Ayr a month or so ago, and I met disabled people whose lives have been turned around by getting work through Fair Start Scotland, and I'm sure you've heard similar stories, and it's obviously it's very humbling and heartwarming to hear how their lives have been transformed by getting into work. So there's a lot of really good stuff happening at the moment, but as I said before, if there's gaps, clearly we want to know.
Yeah, we did meet with clients in Dundee, and it was great to hear their experiences of support and how it had changed their lives. We did in Dundee, though, discuss the unmet need. So while the organisation did work with quite a lot of people, they still recognised there was a huge unmet need out there of people who just weren't accessing services and weren't getting into employment. So there is untapped potential and opportunity within our workforce that, you know, we want to see the government make sure the target is reached and that there's more investment put in and that group is supported. The final question I wanted to ask was around the Social Enterprise Scotland report, which talked about the pay gap. So as well as the disability employment gap, there is a pay gap, and for every pound a non-disabled employee earns, a disabled employee earns 83 pence. It is almost a £4,000 gap a year in terms of salary people receive. Is that coming under the government's Fair Work agenda? Is that something that has been looked at? Is that something that's been, you know, how do we address this issue of pay gap for disabled people?
Yes, we are aware of that, and it is part of our thinking for the Fair Work agenda. The disability pay gap is, under devolved responsibilities, you know, we're limited in what we can do, but we want to look at ways of involving the Fair Work agenda. Actually, I think the House of Commons committee looked at this as well, and I think one of their views was they weren't pressing for mandatory reporting of pay because they felt it might disadvantage people getting onto the first rung of the ladder, disabled people getting into the workplace to start off. So I'm sure there's a whole lot of debate around that. But all I can say is that, yes, it's part of our Fair Work thinking, and it's quite a complex issue to address, again, because we can only address that through Fair Work and influencing people and employers. We don't have any legislative power over that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. That brings us to the end of this morning's evidence session. I thank the Minister and the officials for the evidence we've heard this morning, and I'll now move into a private session.